This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book: The Life of Poggio Bracciolini. Author: William Shepherd. Chapter 1. Birth of Poggio, his education at Florence, John of Ravenna, Poggio goes to Rome, enters into the service of Boniface IX, State of Italy, Schism of the West, Urban VI, the Antipope Clement VII, Boniface IX, Distracted State of Italy, the Antipope Benedict XIII, Wars in Italy, Letter of Poggio, Poggio's arrival in Rome, Innocent VII, Poggio introduces Leonardo Aretino into the Pontifical Chancery, Memoirs of Leonardo, his contest with Jacopo di Angelo, Insurrection in Rome, Gregory XII, Alexander V, Distractions of the Pontificate, Poggio visits Florence, John XXII, Leonardo Aretino elected Chancellor of Florence, his marriage and letter to Poggio, convocation of the Council of Constance. Poggio, the son of Guccio Bracciolini, was born on the 11th day of February, in the year 1380, at Terranuova, a small town situated in the territory of the Republic of Florence, not far from Arezzo. He derived his baptismal name from his grandfather, concerning whose occupation and circumstances the scanty memorials of the times in which he lived do not furnish any satisfactory information. From his father, Poggio inherited no advantages of rank or fortune. Guccio Bracciolini, who exercised the office of notary, was once indeed possessed of considerable property, but being either by his own imprudence or by misfortune involved in difficulties, he had recourse to the destructive assistance of an usurer, by whose rapacious artifices his ruin was speedily completed, and he was compelled to fly from the pursuit of his creditors. But whatever might be the disadvantages under which Poggio laboured, in consequence of the embarrassed state of his father's fortune, in a literary point of view, the circumstances of his birth were singularly propitious. At the close of the 14th century, the writings of Petrarca and Boccaccio were read with avidity, and the labours of those eminent revivers of letters had excited throughout Italy the emulation of the learned. The day star had now pierced through the gloom of mental night, and the dawn of literature was gradually increasing in brilliancy. The city of Florence was, at this early period, distinguished by the zeal with which its principal inhabitants cultivated and patronized the liberal arts. It was consequently the favorite resort of the ablest scholars of the time, some of whom were induced by the offer of considerable salaries, to undertake the task of public instruction. In this celebrated school, Poggio applied himself to the study of the Latin tongue, under the direction of Giovanni Malpaino, more commonly known by the appellation of John of Ravenna. This eminent scholar had, for a period of nearly 15 years, been honored by the friendship, and benefited by the precepts of Petrarca, under whose auspices he made considerable progress in the study of morals, history, and poetry. After the death of his illustrious patron, he delivered public lectures on polite literature, first at Venice and afterwards at Florence. At the latter place, besides Poggio, the following celebrated literary characters were formed by his instructions: Leonardo Aretino, Palla Strozza, Roberto Rossi, Paolo Vergerio the Elder, Omnibuono Vicentino, Guarino Veronese, Carlo Aretino, Ambrogio Traversari, and Francesco Barbaro. It has been asserted by most of the writers who have given an account of the early history of Poggio that he acquired a knowledge of the Greek language at the Florentine University under the tuition of the celebrated Manuel Chrysaloras, but it is evident from a letter addressed by him to Niccolò Niccoli that he did not commence his Greek studies till the year 1424, when he entered upon them at Rome, trusting for success in this new pursuit to his own industry, guided by the occasional instructions of a friend of his of the name of Rinuccio, an accomplished scholar, who afterwards became secretary to Pope Nicholas V. When he had attained a competent knowledge of the Latin language, Poggio quitted Florence, and went to Rome in the year 1403. Soon after his arrival in that city, on the recommendation of his venerated tutor Coluccio Salutati, he obtained the appointment of secretary to the Cardinal Rudolfo Marimori, Bishop of Bari, and in the month of August or September in the ensuing year, he entered into the service of the reigning pontiff Boniface IX, in the capacity of writer of the Apostolic Letters. AD 1403. At the time of Poggio's admission into the pontifical chancery, Italy was convulsed by war and faction. The Kingdom of Naples was exposed to the horrors of anarchy, consequent upon a disputed succession to the throne. Many of the cities of Lombardy, now the unresisting prey of petty tyrants, now struggling to throw off the yoke, were the miserable theatres of discord and of bloodshed. The ambition of the Lord of Milan had carried fire and sword from the borders of Venice to the gates of Florence. The ecclesiastical state was exposed to the predatory incursions of banditti, and the cities over which, as portions of the patrimony of St. Peter, the Pope claimed the exercise of authority, took advantage of the weakness of the Roman court to free themselves from its oppression. At the same time, the luster of the pontificate was dimmed by the schism, which for the space of more than 20 years had divided the sentiments and impaired the spiritual allegiance of the Christian community. As this celebrated ecclesiastic feud, which is commonly distinguished by the name of the Schism of the West, commenced only 2 years before the birth of Poggio, as no fewer than 5 of his patrons were implicated in its progress and consequences, and as it was terminated by the Council of Constance, which assembly he attended in quality of secretary to John XXII, it will be necessary to enter a little at large into its history. The joy experienced by the inhabitants of Rome, on the translation of the papal court from Avignon to its ancient residence, by Gregory XI, was suddenly damped by the death of that pontiff, which event took place on the 28th of March 1378. The Romans were apprehensive that if the choice of the conclave should fall upon a native of France, he would again remove the Holy See beyond the Alps. They sighed for the restoration of that splendor with which the pomp of the successors of St. Peter had formerly graced their city. Their breasts glowed with indignation when they saw the states of the church, in consequence of the absence of its chief, successively falling under the dominion of usurpers. During the residence of the popes at Avignon, the devout pilgrimages, once so copious a source of gain to the inhabitants of the capital of Christendom, had been suspended, the tombs of the martyrs had been neglected, and the churches were fast hastening to decay. Dreading the renewal and the aggravation of these evils, the Roman clergy and populace assembled in a tumultuous manner, and signified to the cardinals, who happened to be at Rome at the time of the death of Gregory XI, their earnest wishes that they would appoint some illustrious Italian to fill the pontifical chair. Amidst the clamors of the people, the conclave was held in the Vatican, under the protection of a guard of soldiers. This assembly was composed of 13 French and 4 Italian cardinals. Notwithstanding this preponderance of ultramontane suffrages, in consequence, as Platina says, of a disagreement among the French, or more probably, as was afterwards alleged by the Gallic ecclesiastics, in consequence of the overawing influence of the Roman populace, the election was concluded in favour of a Neapolitan, Bartolomeo, Archbishop of Bari, on whom the conclave conferred the name of Urban VI. The French cardinals, after protesting against his nomination to the papal chair, as an act in which they had been obliged to concur through a dread of rousing the popular indignation, fled from the city. In the course of a little time, however, they returned to Rome, and made their peace with Urban by confirming his election, and paying him the customary homage. But this reconciliation was not lasting. The manners of Urban were haughty and stern, and his disposition was severe and revengeful. Disgusted by his pride and dreading the effects of his resentment, the foreign cardinals again withdrew, first to Anani and afterwards to Fondi, a town situated in the territories of Naples. Here, Being emboldened by the protection of Joanna, queen of that country, they renewed their protest against the election of Urban, and proceeding to form a new conclave, they proclaimed the Cardinal of Ginevra under the name of Clement VII, the true successor of St. Peter. This was the beginning of that schism, which for so long a space of time perplexed the true believers, by the inexplicable phenomenon of the coexistence of two supreme and infallible heads of the Church, each prescribing his competitor, and fulminating the terrors of damnation against the adherents of his rival. In this contest, the Gallic cardinals did not restrict themselves to the use of spiritual weapons. They assembled a body of mercenary soldiers, whom they employed in making an incursion into the Roman territory. These troops were at first successful in their operations, but engaging the pontifical army near Marina, they were defeated with considerable loss. The resentful spirit of Urban, stimulated by the hostile conduct of the rebellious cardinals, prompted him to meditate a severe revenge. He instantly dispatched an ambassador to Lodovico, King of Hungary, with instructions to proffer to that monarch his assistance in punishing the Queen of Naples for the imputed murder of her husband Andrew, brother to the Hungarian sovereign, who it was alleged had, with her concurrence, been put to death by Luigi, Prince of Taranto. Lodovico, who had long thirsted for vengeance, eagerly accepted the offers of Urban and gave orders to Carlo, son of Luigi di Durazzo, the descendant of Charles II, and heir apparent to the throne of Naples, to march with the Hungarian troops, which were then engaged in hostilities against the Venetians, and to cooperate with the Pope in an attack upon the Kingdom of Naples. Carlo, after taking Arezzo and making peace with the Florentines on the condition of their lending him 40,000 crowns of gold, repaired to Rome, where he held a conference with Urban. Thence he directed his march to Naples, of which city he easily made himself master. Joanna, after sustaining a short siege in the Castello Nuovo, was taken prisoner, and according to the directions of the inexorable King of Hungary, smothered between two mattresses. This vindictive deed being perpetrated, Urban repaired to Naples, and according to the terms of an agreement which had been concluded, before the departure of the Prince of Hungary from Rome, he demanded, on behalf of his nephew, the possession of the Principality of Capua and of several other places in the Kingdom of Naples. On Carlo's refusing to accede to this demand, Urban, with characteristic impetuosity, had recourse to threats, to which the king answered by putting the pontiff for some days under an arrest. Urban, dissembling his indignation, requested and obtained of the prince permission to retire to Nocera for the benefit of his health. The first step which he took on his arrival at that place was to strengthen its fortifications and recruit its garrison. He then proceeded to the nomination of new cardinals and threw seven members of the Sacred College into prison, alleging that at the instigation of Carlo and of his rival Clement, they had formed a conspiracy against his life. Having cited the Neapolitan monarch to appear and answer to the charges which he had to prefer against him, he proceeded to his trial. Carlo treated the summons with contempt, and sent Count Alberico, Grand Constable of his kingdom, at the head of an army to lay siege to Nocera. Urban, escaping from that city, embarked with his prisoners on board some Genoese galleys, which had been prepared to aid his flight. Exasperated to the highest degree of cruelty, the fugitive pontiff vented his fury on the captive cardinals, five of whom he caused to be tied up in sacks and thrown into the sea. On the death of Carlo, who, having usurped the throne of Hungary, which belonged of right to Maria, the daughter of the late monarch, was murdered by assassins hired by the deposed queen, Urban endeavoured to make himself master of the Kingdom of Naples. Being frustrated in this attempt, he returned to Rome, where he died on the 15th of October, 1389. We may easily credit the assertion of Platina that few were the persons who wept at his death. Poggio, in a letter to Angelotto, Cardinal of St. Mark, ascribes the violent conduct of Urban to a derangement of intellect, consequent upon his elevation to the pontifical dignity, and he has recorded in his Facetiae an anecdote which may be quoted as proving the prevalence of an opinion that he was afflicted with insanity. AD 1389, Urban was succeeded by Boniface IX, a Neapolitan of the family of the Tomacelli, who was raised to the chair of St. Peter at the early age of 30 years. The distracted state of Italy required indeed the exertions of a pontiff, endowed with the vigor and activity of the prime of life. That beautiful country was the devoted prey of war, rapine, and civil discord. The native country of Poggio did not escape the general calamity. Galeazzo, Lord of Milan, having declared war against Florence and Bologna, sent a powerful body of forces under the command of Giovanni Ubaldino, with orders to lay waste the territories of those states. In this extremity, the Florentines dispatched a considerable army, under the command of their general Orguto, to make a diversion in the Milanese, and successfully solicited the assistance of Stephen, Duke of Bavaria, and of the Count d'Armagnac. The campaign was opened with brilliancy by the conquest of Padua, but the Duke of Bavaria, having been seduced from his fidelity to his allies by the tempting offers of the enemy, returned to his own dominions. The Count d'Armagnac, descending into Italy by the way of Turin, with the intention of cooperating with Orguto, who had advanced to Bergamo, was also successful in his first operations. But his troops, encountering the enemy under the walls of Alessandria, were put to the rout, and the Count himself, exhausted by his exertions, was carried a prisoner into the town, where he soon afterwards expired in consequence, it is said, of drinking a copious draught of cold water. In these critical circumstances, the Florentines were greatly indebted to the extraordinary military talents of Orguto, who, with an inferior force, effected a retreat through the heart of the Milanese, and held in check the army of Galeazzo, which had made an eruption into the Tuscan territories. Both parties being at length weary of a contest which was productive only of mutual injury, they listened to the paternal admonitions of Boniface, who interposed between them in the quality of mediator, and, under the auspices of the pontiff and the Duke of Genoa, a peace was concluded between Galeazzo and the Florentines, on the basis of mutual restitution. When will a sufficient number of instances have been recorded by the pen of history, of nations harassing each other by the outrages of war, and after years of havoc and bloodshed, when exhausted by exertions beyond their natural strength, agreeing to forget the original subject of dispute, and mutually to resume the station which they occupied at the commencement of the contest? Were subjects wise, what would be their reflections when their rulers, after the most lavish waste of blood, coolly sit down and propose to each other the status quo ante bellum? Happy would it be could the status quo be extended to the widow and the orphan, to the thousands and tens of thousands, who, in consequence of the hardships and accidents of war, are doomed to languish out the remnant of their lives in torment and decrepitude. AD 1393. In the year 1393, the anti-pope Clement VII, dying at Avignon, the schismatic cardinals, still persisting in their rebellion against the Italian pontiff, elected as the legitimate successor of St. Peter, Pietro da Luna, who assumed the name of Benedict XIII. For the space of 5 years after the pacification of Genoa, Florence enjoyed the blessings of peace, but at the end of that period its tranquility was again disturbed by the ambition of Galeazzo, who had now obtained from the Emperor Wenceslaus the title of Duke of Milan. This turbulent chieftain, being encouraged by the death of Orguto, the experienced commander of the Florentine forces, sent into Tuscany a strong body of troops, which made incursions to the very gates of the capital. Ruin and devastation attended the progress of the Milanese forces, who laid waste the country with fire and sword, and led a great number of the inhabitants into captivity. The following letter, addressed on a similar occasion by Poggio to the Chancellor of Siena, is at once a document of the misery to which the small states of Italy were at this time exposed in consequence of the wasteful eruptions of their enemies, and a record of the benevolent dispositions of the writer's heart. I could have wished that our correspondence had commenced on other grounds than the calamity of a man for whom I have a great regard, and who has been taken captive, together with his wife and children, whilst he was engaged in the cultivation of my estate. I am informed that he and one of his sons are now languishing in the prisons of Siena. Another of his children, a boy of about 5 years of age, is missing, and it is not known whether he is dead or alive. What can exceed the misery of this lamentable destiny? I wish these distresses might fall upon the heads of their original authors, but alas, the wretched rustics pay the forfeit of the crimes of others. When I reflect on the situation of those on whose behalf I now intercede with you, my writing is interrupted by my tears. For I cannot help contemplating in the eye of imagination the woe-worn aspect of the father, the pallid countenance of the mother, the exquisite grief of the unhappy son. They have lost everything except their life, which is bereft of all its comforts. For the father, the captors demand by way of ransom 10 for the son, 40 florins. These sums it is impossible for them to raise, as they have been deprived of their all by the rapacity of the soldiers, and if they do not meet with assistance from the well-disposed, they must end their days in captivity. I take the liberty of earnestly pressing this case upon your consideration, and I entreat you to use your utmost exertions to redeem these unfortunate people on the lowest terms possible. If you have any regard for my entreaties, or if you feel that affection which is due from one friend to another, I beseech you with all possible importunity to undertake the care of this wretched family and save them from the misery of perishing in prison. This you may effect by exerting your interest to get their ransom fixed at a low rate. Whatever must be paid on this account must be advanced by me. I trust my friend Pietro will, if it be necessary, assist you in this affair. I must request you to give me an answer, informing me what you can do, or rather what you have done, to serve me in this matter. I say what you have done, for I know you are able, and I trust you are willing to assist me. But I must hasten to close my letter, lest the misery of these unhappy people should be prolonged by my delay. The uneasiness which the Florentines experienced, in consequence of the hostile incursions of Galeazzo's forces, was considerably augmented by the accession of territory and of strength, which that enterprising warrior at this time obtained by the acquisition of the cities of Bologna, Pisa, Siena, and several fortresses bordering on the territories of the Republic. Perugia, also having thrown off its allegiance to the Pope, had sheltered itself from his indignation under the protection of the Duke of Milan. The year of the Jubilee was now approaching, and the Romans, ever delighted with the frivolity of magnificent spectacles, sent a deputation to Boniface, who had studiously withdrawn from Rome, requesting him to honor his capital with his presence. With this request, Boniface hesitated to comply, alleging, as the reason of his hesitation, that the choice of magistrates which the Roman people had lately made was by no means pleasing to him. Unwilling to forego the amusements and profits of the approaching festival, the compliant citizens of Rome gratified the pontiff with the selection of the principal offices of state, and moreover, supplied him with a considerable sum of money. Boniface, in return for these acts of submission, vouchsafed to make his public entry into Rome, and employed the money which he had received as the price of his condescension in fortifying the mole of Adrian, in modern times better known by the name of the Castle of St. Angelo, and other posts which gave him the command of the city. Thus had the Romans the satisfaction of celebrating the Jubilee with extraordinary pomp, at the expense of the remnant of their liberty. AD 1400, in the meantime the Florentines, being hard-pressed by the Duke of Milan, derived a ray of hope from the assistance of the newly elected Emperor Robert Duke of Bavaria, who promised to come to their aid with a powerful body of troops. The joy which they felt on this occasion was, however, but of short continuance, for soon after his entrance into Italy, the emperor was totally defeated by the Duke of Milan, and the remnant of his army being driven over the mountains, was obliged to take shelter in the city of Trent. By the retreat of the imperial troops, the Florentines were reduced to the utmost extremity. Abandoned by their allies and exposed to the inroads of their neighbors, they implored the assistance of Boniface. The pontiff, who felt deep resentment against Galeazzo on account of his seizure of several cities in the ecclesiastical state, readily entered into the views of the Florentines, and without hesitation concluded a treaty, by which he engaged to bring into the field an army of 5,000 men, which was to cooperate with the Tuscan forces. But soon after the commencement of the campaign, the Florentines were happily relieved from their anxiety by the death of their inveterate enemy Galeazzo, whose career of conquest was terminated by a fever, of which he died at Marignano on the 3rd of September 1402. Soon after the death of this powerful prince, many cities of which he had at different times forcibly taken possession were seized by various petty tyrants, who took advantage of the odium excited by the vices of his son and successor Giovanni Maria, and Boniface availed himself of the general confusion to reduce Bologna and Perugia to their ancient allegiance to the Papal See. It has been already observed that Poggio arrived in Rome in the year 1403. He was then in the 24th year of his age. At this dangerous season, though animated with a lively fancy, and stimulated by an ardent constitution, he was not allured into dissipation by the temptations of a corrupt and luxurious court. We learn indeed from the introductory conversation of his dialogue on avarice that the appointments of the pontifical secretaries were not very splendid. Antonio Lusco, one of the interlocutors in that dialogue, is there represented as declaring that their income was scarcely sufficient to maintain the dignity of their office. It is probable, therefore, that the scantiness of Poggio's revenues had no unfavorable influence on his moral conduct and his studies. In the preface to his Historia Disceptativa Convivialis, he acknowledges that he frequently had recourse to literary pursuits, in order to beguile the anxiety which he experienced in consequence of the narrowness of his circumstances. Poverty is not unfrequently the parent of knowledge, and the stern but salutary guardian of virtue. Whatever might be the cause, certain it is that Poggio diligently devoted his leisure hours to study, and cultivated the acquaintance of those whose conversation might tend to the improvement of his mind. As literary pursuits had at this era acquired the currency of fashion, the character of the scholar was frequently found united with that of the man of the world. To this circumstance we may ascribe the union of learning, politeness, and knowledge of the human heart, which shines so conspicuously in the writings of Poggio. On the 1st of October 1404, Poggio sustained a considerable loss by the death of his patron, Boniface IX. "Nothing would have been wanting," says Platina, "to complete the glory of this pontiff, had he not tarnished the lustre of his fame by his excessive partiality towards his relations. These flocked in crowds to Rome, and the numerous acts of simony of which they were guilty greatly impaired the authority of the keys." AD 1404, on the death of Boniface, Cosmo, Cardinal of Santa Croce, was elected to the pontificate, and assumed the name of Innocent VII. The new pontiff was by no means insensible of the merits of Poggio, whom he continued in the office to which he had been promoted by the favour of Boniface. He appears indeed to have treated him with particular kindness and respect. Poggio availed himself of his interest with Innocent to testify the sincerity of his friendship for Leonardo Aretino, who during his residence at Florence had been the associate of his studies and the companion of his festive hours. Leonardo, whose paternal appellation was Bruni, derived the name of Aretino from Arezzo, in which city he was born in the year 1370. His parents, though not graced by the honors of nobility, held a respectable rank in society, and were sufficiently wealthy to be enabled to bestow on their son a good education. In his early youth, Leonardo was incited to a love of letters by an extraordinary accident. A body of French troops, who were marching to Naples.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.